Okay, so it's 4 o'clock, I'm gonna get going. My name is Mark Florida, I'm a program manager on the Configuration Manager team. This is obviously the overview session. Mai and Barniv will be coming up in a little bit to present, you know, kind of the middle part of this deck, but I'll get going on the top of it. So this is the overview session. So what we'll do is we'll really talk about a wide range of different topics that apply to Service Pack 1. Before getting into the kind of the depths of what we've done in Service Pack 1, I'm going to take a step back and talk about some of the improvements that we've made in terms of a cumulative update that's gone out and some other changes that have recently been released on top of the shipping products. When you kind of think about what to get out of this session, it's, again, a broad overview. Understand the broad scope of what it looks like. And it's really, you know, I think the one thing we want everyone to kind of walk away knowing is that consumerization IT, it's, you know, this isn't something new. Many, you know, several years ago we might have talked about this as a new concept, but I think everyone knows what that is now. And what we're trying to do is really show you how using Configuration Manager and Windows Intune, you can really start to go after those scenarios more. We'll then get into some, you know, meat of, you know, how can you use Configuration Manager to deploy Windows 8, and then also, again, just a litany of changes that have been made to the product. So we got a lot of different topics, and we just sort of rattle through them as fast as we can in the allotted time that we have. And then we have follow-up breakout sessions, which go much deeper in detail in each of these areas. So before kind of diving into just the normal overview of what SP1 is about, what I wanted to do is just sort of provide some information that we typically have provided at MMS in the past. So this is just kind of just some very interesting things that we look at from an engineering perspective is how customers are using our product. What are the features that are most commonly used? So when people opt in to, you know, opt into providing feedback, we're able to harvest that and make product improvements. So it's really no surprise that one of the top use features is collection management. It's the thing you have to do to really get anything in our product working in terms of deploying software updates, deploying applications, et cetera. One of the things that we're seeing, too, now in the last several months is we're really seeing a heck of a lot more adoption of the application management feature, which came out in the original 2012 release. We're starting to see statistically that the amount of use of application management is starting to get closer to what we had with our traditional package program software distribution. So that's just great to see. Great to see that people are starting to embrace that feature and starting to really kick the tires and starting to use it in production. And then the other features that we continue to see, and the list was too long here to put it all in there, but we still see people using Config Manager for software updates, reporting. I didn't put, you know, inventory and some other things. I kind of encapsulated all in reports. The other kind of interesting use trend that we're seeing in the product, especially recently, is a lot of operating system deployment work is going out. You know, I think for Microsoft, we're hopeful that's, you know, a bunch of Windows 8 deployments. I can't really tell what you're deploying. All I know is people are deploying a decent amount of operating systems right now. And then the other thing that we've seen, too, is there's been a pretty healthy uptake of downloading SP1, downloading Cumulative Update 1 as well. Some of you can see the top sort of five things that have been fixed in that release. Probably most notably there at the bottom is support is extending support in Mac for 10.8. So now that's just kind of a snapshot of some, you know, what's going on in our kind of current deployments. But to take a step back, what we are doing as a product is looking at that consumerization trend, looking at scenarios like bring your own device. And we realize that this is a, you know, a big shift for companies. And the way we think about it is we think of it in really kind of two different phases. We think of it first as trying to empower the end users, trying to make sure we can provide an experience where the end user can get access to their applications, they can be productive from the devices that they love, they can work from their Surface devices and other of those more modern platforms that are out there. But we also look at it from the IT perspective of making sure the necessary controls are in place so that you can realistically empower end users to work from other devices. And that's kind of what you see on the right-hand side of there. So on the left-hand side, it's all about Configuration Manager and Windows Intune and what can be done to deliver capabilities to the end user. And then obviously with Configuration Manager, we have the ability to implement additional controls using things like software updates and DCM. But we also have a myriad of other products in Microsoft around Active Directory, Azure AD, being able to provide a common identity. So as users move between different services, different devices, they're able to get a very consistent experience, and the IT administrator is able to provide access based on that that kind of common identity that you have. To kind of get a little bit deeper specifically into the products that we're going to talk about, you know, again, kind of when we think about empowering the end user, it's about allowing them to work from the devices that they, you know, really want to work from. It's about providing sort of self-service capabilities like we have with our application catalog. It's about being able to allow a level of personalization without having IT come in and dictate every last sort of experience for that end user. And then on the other side of the equation is what IT needs to be productive. What we see is something we call unified management. And with unified management, it's really bringing together the best of Windows Intune with the best of Configuration Manager so that we can have a single management console so people don't have to move between two different products. We see the ability to manage security and compliance all in one place, be able to put those necessary controls there so that you can feel protected. Leverage products like System Center Endpoint Protection to keep protected, to stay protected. And then also what we're looking to do is to try to remove more and more of the management complexity that's needed in order to manage these remote clients. So what this kind of looks like just as a kind of visualization here is that, you know, the kind of the fuzzy little guy at the bottom of the screen, that's the administrator. This administrator, what they will see is just a single console. To them, this unified story of Configuration Manager and Windows Intune is just the Configuration Manager console. What they're able to do there is the same features they're accustomed to working on today, application management, software updates, etc. They're doing those things in a surface they're familiar with. They don't have to be retrained on how to then manage devices that are being managed through Intune. It's just a single, consistent experience, the experience they've been used to. Then what happens is, after you sort of go into the console and you fill out a subscription, which is a pretty simple task to complete in the console, what Configuration Manager does is it builds, in essence, a connector between your site server and Windows Intune. That way, as you go into the normal Config Manager console, all of those instructions that you put into the console will then be replicated up to the cloud for you. And the net result of that is, depending on the devices or platforms that you're looking to manage, they will be managed through different back-end systems. So if you have your traditional x86, 64 devices, your Windows To Go devices, your Android, Mac devices, those all get managed out of your Config Manager hierarchy in the back end. And your more modern devices like Windows RT, Windows Phone, etc., those get managed via Intune. But again, the experience for the administrator is just, it's unified. You just don't know that that's happening in terms of how you manage features, how you work yourselves through the console to complete tasks. So to kind of maybe tell this story in a slightly different way, just in the summary points, is that we want to put the end user in control of their experience. We want to provide them with the ability to control what software that they want to get. We want to move towards more of a model of it's pull software distribution versus push software distribution. But with that said, we know that that doesn't always work in all cases. And that's where we see the IT pro still has the ability to enact the changes and the policies that they really need to have in their environment. So as much as we may want to have this world where the kind of end user can never be encumbered, we know that there are critical controls that have to be put in place. And then that's where we provide an IT experience for the IT administrator to really manage at the, hopefully, the least common denominator so they can control what's really important for them to control and not have to control every aspect of a given device. So what we're going to do then is break this deck that's very similar to what we've done in years past. We're going to talk about really three sort of phases. The first phase is around empowering the end user. It's all scenarios designed around how do you make the end user productive from what device they're on, and then what are the management capabilities that are there to enable that and also to help protect IT resources. Then we have improvements that we made to help in the infrastructure area. And then we follow it with kind of a, you know, just sort of a set of improvements that we've made to really help optimize the administrative experience and in some cases the end user experience as well. So with empowering the end user, I'm just going to kind of get into this, is that what we see is a world where it's nothing, you know, it's nothing too out of the ordinary. It's, we see just a ton of different devices. And when Windows 8, the whole wave of devices came out, we now see where Microsoft is positioned, where we have basically a whole slew of different form factors to be able to manage, to be able to provide an experience to end users depending on what they need. You know, what we see is the ability using Windows 8 to get a desired experience to meet your needs. You know, for example, if we have a developer writing code, they most likely are going to be using, you know, traditional laptop, desktop. They'll need, you know, the capabilities that that device has. However, if you're traveling, maybe a tablet device is needed. And then there's a whole myriad of options in the middle. You might have Ultrabooks. You might have a whole slew of different devices. The point being is that, as I think everyone knows, it's no longer a situation where we have sort of predictable targets. We don't have the laptop, desktop, and that's about it. That's what we manage model anymore. We have now a whole wide range of Windows 8 capable devices that need to be they need to be managed, and they need to be ready for end users to be able to do their work from those. And then add to that heterogeneous devices. You know, obviously Apple, Android, those bring to bear a number of different platform options in themselves. And we as a management product, if we're truly serious about providing the end user the ability to work from any device, the device they really want to work from, we can't ignore heterogeneous devices. And that's where we have to look at how can we manage the user, how can we provide capabilities to the user, but allow them to work across all these different devices. So at kind of a macro layer, this is actually where we sort of focus this whole empower part of this presentation, is it's really about those capabilities that we have on these different device types. So with kind of the So when we thought about these IW devices, we thought about how can we provide management to these devices in a way that, you know, kind of focuses our design efforts. And what we found out was that, or what we landed on was, we really want to, again, empower the IW, help protect the organization, and that was all focused around how do we move the admin experience away from trying to manage every detail of the device to instead managing the essence, you know, the essential controls that you might want to have on a given device. You know, a good kind of analogy to this is that in your traditional domain join world, what you would potentially do is flatten, image a box, put a WIM on there, and then from that day forward, you would sort of tightly manage what could be done on that device. You might restrict administrative access and do some things to really lock down what that experience looks like. If you get into scenarios where end users are bringing devices to work, or they have different form factors, or different platforms, I should say, that just don't even support that level of control, you as the administrator can't really work in that model anymore where you can really control every aspect of the device. And to some extent, we don't know if that's even the best model to move towards anyways. Is if we really kind of go and we ask customers what they're most interested in doing, it's really about controlling the things that are most interesting to protect. And a lot of times that comes down to protecting the apps and protecting the corporate data. It's not about making a certain registry key is set a certain way. The other thing, again, I've kind of reinforced this earlier, is that as we sort of think about unification between Configuration Manager and Intune, we wanted to leverage the best, you know, the best elements of both. Windows Intune is great in terms of being able to provide a cloud-hosted, available from anywhere type of offering for your mobile devices. It meets that scenario to the T. You know, those mobile devices tend to connect from anywhere, so why not hit a cloud backend? That's wonderful. But when you think about your more traditional devices, you know, we just know that customers aren't either ready or make sense to move all those capabilities to the cloud at this point in time. So we need to have that nice, simple experience for the administrator so that they're able to manage to the user, they're able to deliver services to the user, but they can do it all through a single pane of glass. And then the other thing we wanted to do was really kind of focus on making sure as you bring in the sort of unification story together, that there isn't a lot of retrain that's needed. You can basically plug in, tune in to your existing Config Manager workflows, and you should just be able to follow those. You shouldn't have to kind of learn a new way to do software distribution, learn a new way to do whatever that feature is, to be able to get on board quickly. So that's kind of the goals that we looked at when we went through and kind of thought about how do we bring these two worlds together, Config Manager and Intune, and again, kind of provide an experience where you can manage users, you can empower users across devices, but you don't get, you know, hit bad in terms of having to manage two different products. So with to kind of get into the devices a bit more, what we have is we'll have kind of several slides here where we'll sort of break down different areas of the devices. But to kind of start with, we have Windows 8 and Windows Phone 8. And from a management capabilities perspective, there's a number of similarities between Windows 8 devices and obviously more traditional, let's say, a Windows 7 x86 64 device. You're able to do, you know, a myriad of the same things. But obviously Windows 8 brings new capabilities to the table, like, for example, the Windows 8 apps or having Windows 8 apps in the App Store. You're able to do all of those things on a Windows 8 device. You're also able to do things like pull software distribution on not just a Windows 8 device, but also a Windows 7 device. You're also able to do settings management. You know, for example, you're able to, you know, enforce spell check or do, you know, a myriad of other settings options, both in Windows 8 as well as on x86, you know, past versions of Windows as well. Now, when we get into Windows RT and Windows Phone, the story gets a little more kind of nuanced. When we get into those platforms, those were platforms that were specifically designed for, you know, the consumer, designed for the end user. And what we've done working kind of as a broader Microsoft team was we wanted, again, to empower the end user, try to provide an awesome experience on those devices, while at the same time providing the essential controls. So what you're able to do is you're able to manage Windows RT devices. You're able to define critical settings. You're able to distribute software. And you're able to measure compliance. But you're not able to do certain things that you can see at the bottom of the screen there. You're not able to push software. You're not able to sort of image those devices. And the reason being is that when we kind of initially went after managing these platforms, we specifically kind of focused on a scenario that was more around managing the end user, the consumerization type of devices, those devices you might bring into work. We didn't necessarily approach it as a device that the company might provide for a given end user. So that's kind of why we have this split of features as it currently sits, is that you can kind of think about those sort of top devices as these more modern platforms, except for Windows 8 gets a little tricky because it has different variants. But you think of those devices as ones where they're kind of these modern ones. They get managed by Intune. You can do things like make software available. But if you need that sort of more in-depth control management, that's where you get into it with sort of your Intel, traditional Intel x86-based solutions, you know, such as Windows 8, just kind of vanilla OS that you can do, or as well as Windows 7 would play out the same way. Oops, excuse me. So what you can do in Windows 8 Blue is, Windows 8 is very similar to what you can do in terms of the scenarios that are supported for Windows 7. So if you're familiar with operating system deployment, this shouldn't be something new for you. This is really just sort of the recap for people who aren't as familiar with operating system deployments. So with Windows 8, what you're able to do is we have a set of scenarios which are really fundamentally kind of similar. They're about giving a new machine. When you get a new computer, you're able to go through, let's say, a fresh install experience, or you're able to hit the F12 button and go off of a Pixie experience. And that's one of just sort of creating, you know, a brand new machine for a given user. We then have a pair of scenarios which are similar. They kind of match the same genre, which is really about the end user is getting a replacement. They have their own personal state, you know, like my documents, stuff like that, my settings. They have those on one device. They're getting a new replacement device, and you want to be able to move the state over on those other devices. So using Configuration Manager, save their state off and then move that onto a different device. And the last set of scenarios is that these are really kind of designed for areas where you might have networking challenges or minimal bandwidth or no bandwidth at all. You're able to create media, and then from that media, you're able to do one of two things. You're either able to just completely image the machine based off of media. That's what we call, you know, full offline media. Or you're able to do a thing called pre-stage media. Pre-stage media is designed to be an optimization. So you're able to take, let's say, a WIM image, and you're able to deploy that down. That's such a heavy payload. You're able to use that I shouldn't have said deploy that down. You would take that very large WIM image, you would put that on media, you would then install the WIM, and then once the Configuration Manager client gets installed and is successfully connected to the hierarchy, then you would get additional content to come down, like applications, for example. The other scenario that gets lit up in Windows 8 is Windows to Go. So with Windows to Go, it was designed primarily for contractor, bring your own device scenarios, travel light. You could basically image a set of USB keys, put them in a drawer, pull them out when need be. You could use them as a primary device in terms of, you know, I'm going, you know, I don't have laptops handed out to my employees, but I can go and I can plug it in and I can get a corporate image and I can take it home and put it on my own device at home. So it was designed for a number of sort of flexible workspace scenarios. What we do in Configuration Manager is we support the process in terms of provisioning and managing those devices. So we kind of see our role in Windows to Go as really three main phases. The first one is you're able to create a Windows to Go image. When you create a Windows to Go image, it's actually extremely similar to pre-stage media if you've gone through that scenario. You basically define, here's my WIM, here's all my applications, and you're able to kind of load all of that information on a USB drive. The reason, or the media you want to use, the reason that's interesting is that really helps cut down the provisioning time. You don't have to worry about streaming content down to a device when they want to get up and working. And the other piece that we do too is we'll do the actual provisioning piece. So you basically, in step one, you get all the information down on the device. Step two is really kind of walking through the final setup process, very similar to how you just might do a normal machine imaging. We'll complete that and create a functioning device. And then the last thing that we do is we manage Windows to Go devices. And probably the one wrinkle here that's different than other devices is that we surface that this device, this sort of Windows to Go key, if you will, is actually a Windows to Go device. For example, once a Windows to Go image is actually up and running, it behaves and looks very similar to a normal Windows 8 device. You wouldn't really know that it's Windows to Go. But from a management perspective, you may want to know that it's different. For example, you might have a patch report. Like, if you're using Windows to Go as sort of a backup plan, you don't want to necessarily have a bunch of software updates reports showing non-compliant or showing haven't reported in just because those devices happen to be sitting in a drawer. So that's why we surface the kind of the state, if you will, that a given device is a Windows to Go device. That way you can make decisions as part of your normal reporting process to determine whether you want to do anything with those devices or not differently. The other thing we did with operating system deployment, just in kind of general, this isn't just in general, is that we made enhancements to BitLocker. So the same type of options we have in the wizard where you can pick your BitLocker options, just a new radio option or drop down, I can't remember, shows up where you can basically select TPM plus PIN. And then we also support the new Win8 feature for use-based BitLocker. So use-based BitLocker, for those that are not familiar, the main value of this is speed. You don't have to sit there and wait for the entire drive to be encrypted. What it does is it encrypts as it's laying data down. So it's a marketable improvement in terms of just the raw performance and actually enablement of BitLocker. You don't have to wait several hours to encrypt an entire drive. And then pre-stage media, I mentioned it before with Windows to Go because that was really the reason why we did this work, but it also helps with some other customer DCRs that we've had over time, which is around just general enhancements to that pre-stage scenario. There's a number of times where you might be at a remote location with a satellite link or a really, really kind of small or flaky network connection, where we've had a number of different customers sort of request the ability to say, well, how come I can't just put almost everything down there? Why can't I get my WIM, my apps, my drivers, my 95% case provision down just using media? And then once the device comes online, I can kind of phone home and get those last critical updates. So what's kind of nice about this change is that it really helps simplify the media that you might need to create. You don't need to necessarily create, just 30-odd specific medias for different parts of an organization. What you can really do is kind of create one master one that has a whole bunch of, which has the lion's share of your information in there. And then you can allow Config Manager, after the client comes up and is working, to finish off the unique customization for what kind of target you're actually trying to meet. And now Windows 8 has another sort of feature, which was again kind of driven along the lines of how do we provide a good end user experience. We want to make sure that when that's not good. I swear I didn't do anything. It's back, perfect. So what the feature is called Always On, Always Connected, but really it's about how do you move, how do you help preserve battery life? How do you get a device up and working as quick as possible? And Windows 8 put a lot of plumbing in place to make that happen. And our whole mission with Configuration Manager was to just not get in the way of that. We wanted to be good citizens on a always-on, always-connected, capable Windows 8 device. And what that meant for us is we just had to do a better job understanding different states. For example, if your battery's low, it's not the best if that's a good time to kick off inventory and let that thing churn and use up more battery. If you don't have a network, there's not a whole lot of point running a task that requires remote content, for example. And also there's the kind of notion, or there's the time frame in a Windows 8 device called the Windows Maintenance Hour. And what we tried to do is leverage that just like any other third party would leverage that to try to provide a consistent experience when activities would happen. And I think the one thing I didn't necessarily include in this slide, just because it gets a little bit into the weeds, is we tried our best to break down some of our longer running processes to try to, you know, I kind of call it peanut buttering, where you basically try to run it maybe longer over time, but less intensive as you're running through that. But again, the whole notion was we just wanted to be good citizens. We didn't want the Config Manager client to be sort of the culprit for why did it take so long to log in? Why did my battery get sucked up? We didn't want our software to be the reason that the end user experience got impacted. So Mayan's going to come up and she's going to talk a little bit about what we did or what we changed in application delivery to, you know, really again kind of help empower the end user.
Thanks, Mark.
Yep. Where's the clicker?
Can you hear me? Yes? No? Okay. I'm Mayan Brenu. I'm a program manager, and over the next 30, 40 minutes or so, I'll cover some more of the great benefits that Service Pack 1 has to offer, and starting with application delivery. With Config Manager 2012, we introduced user-centric application delivery, and what that meant is for an admin who wants to make an application available in their organization, they can really think users first. Now, that's not trivial, because in today's world, a user might have 3, 4, 5 devices. Maybe some of them are their own personal devices that they want to do work from. And so having to keep track of which users are using which devices and which technologies can run on each of these devices is not an easy task. And the Configuration Manager application model just does that for you. You don't have to think about this complexity as you target users with applications. Now, one of the things that it uses for that is user-device relationships. A user is mapped to their primary devices. A device is mapped to its primary users. And so it can light up, it can light up scenarios like maybe if this is the user's primary desktop, then they're getting the MSI deployment. Or maybe they're, if it's a Windows 8, they're getting a Windows 8 deployment. But if this is a VDI session where the user is connected and they're not a primary user, maybe in that case they're getting an AppV or a remote application. This is done through deployment types. And deployment types are really the different technologies that can be used to deploy applications. And this model is extensible. So 2012 provided the set of deployment types out of the box. And on top of that, our partners can create their own deployment types. Citrix is an example for a partner who's doing that, and they actually have a session later in the week to talk about that. This extensibility also enabled us as a product group to easily, in Service Pack 1, add more and more deployment types that really provide maximal productivity for your users on the various devices. And over the next few slides, we're going to run through these. So starting with Windows 8, let me jump right into the console. And what I'm going to show you now is the admin experience for deploying a Windows 8 application. In the keynote in this morning, you saw the end-to-end scenario where the user was actually getting the application, Brad was getting the application on the device. Here, I'm going to focus on the admin experience, and you'll see how familiar it is. If you've used Config Manager 2012, it's really familiar. It's not very different from other deployment types. What I'm going to do is create an application. Now, you can see this list is fairly long now. It has many different types of deployments, and I'm going to go with AppX for Windows 8. I'm going to select one of these Windows 8 packages that I have, Canvas Paint in this case. And I'm just going to quickly run through this this wizard. What it does is it extracts all the information that it needs from the Windows 8 package in order to be able to deploy it on the device. So I'm going to keep the defaults just for the sake of time. And what this is doing now is it's creating an application with a Windows 8 deployment type already in it. Later, I can add more deployment types if I need to. All right, and it's done. Let's find this. There it is. At the bottom here, I can see that the deployment type was created. That's the Windows 8 deployment type. And I'm going to look at properties. So let's look at detection method, for instance. This is all information that Configuration Manager was able to extract from the package itself, and it's as easy as that. So some of these things like the name or the requirement rules, which specific versions are supporting this deployment type or can be applied by this deployment type, you can later edit if you need to. But all the defaults are there, and it's as simple as that. Another very useful deployment type for Windows 8 is Windows 8 apps in the Windows Store. So in this case, imagine that there is an application in the Windows Store that you want to make available for users in your organization. Think Skype, maybe. And you don't want to have to deal with the overhead of repackaging and maintenance. It's already there in the Windows Store. And so what you could do is use this deployment type where all an admin has to do to create is basically point to the link in the Windows Store. Now, the benefit for the admin is clear, minimal overhead. This is great. The benefit for the user is that there is one place that they need to go to get the applications that their IT is providing for them to do their job. So they'll still go to the same portal, to the same catalog, where they're seeing all the applications that are available for them. And in case this is a link to the Windows Store, they're just going to be redirected. Let me talk about AppV, Application Virtualization. Configuration Manager has a long relationship with Application Virtualization. And I want to focus here on the slide on the things that are new in Service Pack 1. So one new thing is support for AppV4.6 SP2. We, with 2012, had support for AppV4.6 SP1. Now we have SP2. And this is interesting because it's the AppV4.6 version that supports Windows 8. The feature set is very similar to what we've had before. So the bigger change really is about AppV5 integration. AppV5 is the recent and glorious AppV version that provides things like better integration with the operating system, a more native user experience, better management. And all that is now supported through Configuration Manager. The great thing is that these two versions can coexist. And it's interesting because organizations that have hundreds of packages are not going to convert them in one day. So during this time, as the applications gradually get converted from 4.6 to 5, both clients can be installed in parallel and both can be managed through Configuration Manager. One of the big changes in terms of the AppV integration is connection groups. If you are familiar with Dynamic Suite Composition, this is the new generation of that. And the scenario is basically two applications, two AppV packages that need to talk to one another. So think Visual Studio and an add-on on top of Visual Studio. By default, AppV packages run in isolation. They each run in their own bubble. In this case, it's just not going to work. The add-on has to run in the same bubble as Visual Studio. And this is what Connection Group allows. Now, as opposed to Dynamic Suite Composition before. This is all configured from the Config Manager console. One place to do all of that, nothing during packaging. It's all in the Configuration Manager console. And it also lights up a new nice scenario that we refer to as Better Together applications, where if you have two applications that are maybe not really dependent on one another, maybe Office and Link, they can each run as a standalone application. However, if they're both present, you want them to be able to talk to one another and get added value, like maybe seeing the presence of recipients in your email. So you can do that with connection groups. All right, metered connection support, another great management capability for Windows 8. And this is an example where we're not just supporting the same scenarios that we supported before for our previous Windows versions. This is a new management capability that's really leveraging what Windows 8 is offering. Metered networks are networks that involve costs. So a good example for that would be a 3G network provided by your mobile operator. And this is very easy to use and set up in Windows 8. The thing to be aware of with that is bill shock. And if you haven't heard the term, this is, you know, the reaction that you might have when you get the bill after exceeding your data caps. So in Config Manager, we really tried to be aware of that and avoid bill shock. It's one thing when you exceeded your data cap. It's another thing where maybe your organization deployed an update that was downloaded to your device on a metered network. So this is a new client setting. And by default, it has the client treating metered networks as though there is no network at all. No network use, nothing whatsoever. Another option is to allow it. This is relevant maybe for organizations that operate their own networks. And there is a middle ground where you could have a limit use of metered networks, maybe just to get settings, get policy, report status. And in that mode, both the admin and the user have full control at the deployment level. So an admin can say, you know, this is a security update. It's critical enough to be deployed even on a metered network. A user getting an application from the catalog over a metered network is going to be asked whether they really want to do that, where it involves cost. Another Windows 8 management capability, user data and settings management. You can now, through Config Manager, control client-side caching, roaming user profile, and folder redirection. These are group policy settings, and you can now manage them in Config Manager. Three benefits. One is it's one place. You no longer have to work through different tools. It's all in Config Manager. Two, it's the same familiar experience for administrators who've worked through Config Manager settings management. It's the same experience. And three, you get all the added value, like detailed compliance reports and remediation. Okay, so we're done with Windows 8 for a while. Over the next few slides, we'll walk through various other platforms, and starting with embedded devices. Embedded devices have their own unique challenges. And historically, we've had embedded device management as an add-on on top of Configuration Manager. Starting with SP1, this is now the same product, part of Configuration Manager itself. And the greatest enhancement in that space for Service Pack 1 is write filter orchestration. When you're managing an embedded device, a lot of times you wouldn't want to allow anyone to apply changes. Think of an ATM, maybe. You don't want any user to be able to go and apply updates on that. When you have write filters applied, management also becomes a challenge. So SP1 controls all of that. It would disable write filters, apply a change, and that could be an application, software update, task sequences. It would apply the change and then re-enable the write filters. All of this is happening during maintenance windows and under the control of the administrator. There are a couple of other improvements for embedded devices. One of these is the ability to deploy OSD directly from the distribution point. So, you know, with embedded devices, space might get very limited, so this would be critical. Mac OS X support is here in Service Pack 1. Mark mentioned that. Service Pack 1 supports Snow Leopard and Lion, and the great news from about a week ago is that with cumulative update 1 for the Mac client, we also support Mountain Lion. The key capabilities are very similar to what we have. So software distribution, settings, hardware inventory, and so on. They are somewhat limited compared to what we have for Windows platforms, but the core functionality is all there. I want to show you the admin experience for creating a Mac deployment type. And this is really just a peek just to have you see how similar it is to managing other platforms. If you want to see the full end-to-end scenario, there is a session on Thursday, I believe, where they'd be demoing this all the way down to the client and some additional great Mac scenarios. So again, I'm creating an application. This time I'm selecting Mac OS X as my deployment type. And here's something that I want you to be aware of. See the file extension, CMMAC? This is a file that is generated by a utility that we're providing with SP1. It's called CMMAC Util. It can run on any Mac device, and what it does is it basically just converts the application files into a format that Configuration Manager can consume and extract information from. Selecting the file. Keeping all the defaults. And that's it. The application was created. All the information that was needed, including the detection, it was all extracted from the package, and I'm ready to deploy it. iOS and Android management capabilities. This is a good example for what Mark was talking about earlier, where you can really leverage the cloud infrastructure to get more. So if you're using your on-premise hierarchy to manage these devices through Exchange Active Sync, you can get basic settings management and device wipe if you need to wipe a device. Through the cloud infrastructure, you're getting a lot more. So first, the settings and device wipe capabilities are enhanced. For settings, there are more settings that you can control. You're also getting compliance at the setting level versus the entire policy. So these are enhanced. Even device wipe is enhanced in a sense because it flows not just through Exchange Active Sync, but also through our mobile device management channels. But really the highlight is pulled the software distribution where users on these devices can browse through catalogs and get the applications that their corporate provided for them on these devices. So really maximizing user productivity. Linux and Unix next. In this area, again, all the core functionality is there. The focus for these is server platforms. And in terms of which specific versions are supported, on the left side, you can see the list of versions that are supported with Service Pack 1. I really want to kind of explain the rationale behind this. So we are going with a model of consistency across Configuration Manager and Operations Manager for a full management, complete management story. The new operating systems are supported within 180 days from the day that they're released and throughout the time that the vendor supports them. And I can tell you that there is a session on Thursday for Linux and Unix management in System Center where they'll give you a sneak peek at new versions that are going to be supported through cumulative update 1 for the Unix and Linux agent. So if you want to get that list, make sure you go to that session on Thursday. All right, that was a lot of new platforms and devices that we covered. Let's talk about the hierarchy, the infrastructure that is needed to support all these clients. And we started this effort with Configuration Manager 2012 to reduce the requirements for infrastructure. Less servers, less sites, reduce the maintenance, and really maximize the number of clients that can be supported on these. This next slide kind of covers reasons for why you would set up a new site or a new role, and it also covers reasons that are no longer relevant. These are things that you may have considered in the past, but are no longer relevant, and we really wanted to make this clear, starting with the central administration site. So you would need a CAS to scale, obviously, if you need more than one primary site, and we'll talk about why you need that, then you'd need a CAS, you need a full hierarchy. Starting from Service Pack 1, you do not need a CAS to future-proof. So, you know, if you're getting close to the 100,000 client limit and you're thinking, maybe in a year or two I'm going to need a full hierarchy, so let's create a CAS just in case, that is no longer needed. You can expand a standalone primary into a CAS, and I have the next slide to show you that. Primary sites, you'd need those, obviously, for scale, also to perhaps reduce the impact of a site failing. You do not need a primary site to delegate administration. So say you have a group of administrators dealing with desktop management and another group with server management. Maybe in the past in Config Manager 2007, you'd create two sites, one for each of these groups, in order for them not to see one another's resources. With 2012, we have role-based administration for exactly that reason. The delegation, the administrative permissions are completely virtual based on scope, and they have nothing to do with hardware. Similar for client settings, by the way. Client settings are applied to collections, nothing to do with the site, and the same goes for language packs. When would you need a secondary site? You need a secondary site to fan out content. So suppose you have a site in London, and you have maybe several smaller offices in Africa with deployment, with distribution points, and maybe the link is slow, and you don't want content to go directly to these DPs. You don't want clients to report status directly to that primary site. You could set up a secondary site in Africa. You do not need a secondary site for throttling, because in Config Manager 2012, this is done at the distribution point level. Distribution points, when we do not need these, for a branch scenario. You would not use branch distribution points in 2012. Instead, you can leverage branch cache support. Okay, I promised the hierarchy expansion illustration. So in this case, you have a primary site. Maybe you just hit the 100,000 limit, 100,000 clients. What you do is as simple as creating a new CAS. And it's important, this has to be a fresh, clean CAS installation. And then you just link the two. You set up a new primary when you need to do that. And that's it. You just got yourself a hierarchy. Here's another great opportunity to use less hardware. In Service Pack 1, we have a distribution point for Windows Azure. It's a distribution point for any cause and purpose, other than it runs in Azure, in the cloud. So in this case, maybe you have a small remote office, and you don't want the overhead of managing the distribution point there. You can just use this distribution point, and it's as easy as setting it up from the console using your Azure account information. A few things to be aware of. There are some exceptions. So these distribution points currently do not support OSD, custom updates, and AppV streaming. If you need those scenarios, the Azure Distribution Point is not the answer for you. However, for any other purpose, it's just another distribution point. You can see reports and so on. It's all there. One other thing about this. In terms of the architecture, we made an effort to minimize the content that the client is downloading directly from the cloud. So one example is full branch cache support. Another example is that for Microsoft updates, the client working against this distribution point would not be downloading the content from there. Instead, it would go to Microsoft updates to get the content. Database replication controls are available in Service Pack 1. In this case, if you have a hierarchy and you have links that you want to control replication for, and I'm talking specifically about hardware inventory, software inventory, and metering, and status messages, these are really the bigger chunks of data. For these, you can now control both when per link the content is going to be replicated. You can choose to use distributed views. Of course, that would mean that the link has to be reliable because the content is not going to, the data is not going to be replicated at all. It relies on these two sites being able to talk to one another. And you can apply a switch for compressing the data before it gets sent. Wake up proxy is a cool new feature in Service Pack 1 that allows you waking up sleeping clients. And the great thing is that this is enabled in deeper networks inside subnets. It basically uses other clients in the network to wake up the sleeping clients. Let me show you. So in this case, we have two clients, and at some point, one of them decides to sleep. Other clients in the network constantly ping one another. And so we have another client realizing that this client is asleep, and it's going to start acting as its manager. What it does is it sends a message to the subnet router and has it route any message that is arriving to itself. It identifies itself with the same MAC address and port, and so when a remote user initiates anything, it could be a remote connection, it could be a deployment, the TCP SYN is getting to the manager. The manager is going to send a wake-up packet to wake the client up, and so when the message is being resent, it just arrives to the client that it was intended for, and that's it. There goes the ACK, and everyone's happy. A few things to be aware of. First of all, three clients need to be up at any point. This is a client setting, I didn't say, by the way. It's a client setting. So you need to thoroughly consider applying that because of these issues. Not all network configurations are supported. Make sure you talk to your network administrator before you choose to do that. There are some states that, for instance, the MAC replacement causes a state known as MAC flap, and some networks identify that as a bad state. All of this information is on TechNet. Make sure you talk to your network admin before you apply this feature. And with that, I'll call Mark to talk about endpoint protection.
Okay, thanks, Mike. So what we did with endpoint protection is we really looked at trying to speed up a few of the actions. So what we ended up doing, if you remember with our kind of RTM release of endpoint protection, is we went after real-time notifications. Basically, if there's a malware outbreak, the administrator needs to know as soon as possible that that issue is occurring. What we did is we implemented some improvements to be able to enact remediation as quick as possible. For example, let's say you got some issue in your environment, you need to modify your policy, or you need to exclude something so that so that something isn't treated as malware. We now have the capabilities for the admin to do that in near real time, all through the console. And the way that we do that is using a kind of a feature we sort of internally refer to as the big green button. It's basically the ability for an admin to just hit an action, and that action is sort of wired up for speed. It doesn't rely on that normal 60-minute polling interval that our client typically has to get new policy. So kind of a decent analogy for this is a phone. So what happens is our client, the way the sort of big green button thing works is We have a dial tone, if you will, that's being maintained between a client and our server. Think of that as just sort of checking in to see if a phone call is coming into play. The administrator is the one who actually places the call. They go in the console, they select a certain action which is wired up for real-time behavior, such as running a full scan, running a quick scan, and that call basically goes to your phone switch here, your server, and says, hey, there's a call, it needs to be picked up. The client simply picks it up and runs that task. It's really just as simple as that. We do some things under the covers that's a little more complicated, like we don't necessarily always maintain all the TCP connections all simultaneously at the same time. We're smart about sort of dropping some things. That's why it's not real time. It ends up where you might see anywhere from 10 seconds to 60-second delay before clients start to pick it up. But we do that so you don't have to worry about performance. You're able to sort of deploy these actions to a very, very large set of clients and have it work without having you to be worried, am I going to oversaturate my servers with running these individual tasks? So what I'm going to do is demonstrate this, and I'm going to hope everything works, because what you can't see is that my demo laptop here is all dark, so something happened. So this is good that hopefully this backup system is working. So what I'm going to do is log into the server here, and then while that's happening, I'm going to log into the client. Okay, so this is just a normal client machine. What I intend to show, if everything works on this backup system, which I'm a little anxious for right now, is you'll basically see that a quick scan is going to now run on this device and hopefully run very quickly from the time in which I select the administrative action. So I'm going to hop back over to the server. There it is. Oh, wrong one. Sorry about that. There it is. So what I had done ahead of time is I created a collection. I called it the EP Endpoint Protection Clients. It's nothing fancy. It's just a direct membership for that demo VM that I have there. And what you can do is you can select this, and let me see if I can get this to look correct. You'll see that there's three actions here for endpoint protection. All of these actions are wired up to this real-time mechanism. And what's kind of neat about this, too, beyond just endpoint protection, is if you invoke that third one, that download definition update, actually what we're doing is we're just basically pressing the software updates capability on the device. So even though we call it download definition, if you ever needed to be able to speed up like a patch distribution, for example, just a normal Windows OS thing, you can actually just use this action. It'll just, you know, hit that normal control panel mechanic that you're probably used to seeing on the client, and it'll just cause software updates to kick in, scan for the latest or missing updates, and then have them apply right away. Let me kind of drop out of this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kick off a quick scan. We provide a little bit of a warning just because of the potential impact that it might have on a client machine, nothing about the actual server as well. And the one thing I wanted to cover real quick while that's getting processed is, where did it go? Sorry. What we also have is the ability to, I kind of call this the get out of jail free card feature, is if you, in order to run anything, let's say an app deployment, you want to evaluate that as quick as possible, or any other features we have, this action right here, download computer policy, is analogous to going into control panel applet and saying request machine policy. So this is your ability to say, I've pushed out a new deployment, or I pushed out something new like a baseline, and I want that to be evaluated right then and there across my clients. You're able to call this action from the console, and it'll go run it on the client as soon as possible. All right, so fingers crossed, everything's working on the client. Let me hop over there. All right, good. So the quick scan's running. If you remember, that screen wasn't showing a progress bar. From what I noticed just by doing these demos a lot and testing it out is it's pretty quick. It takes about 10 seconds or so. The only real gotcha is if you're evaluating this feature yourself in your lab is that when a client first spins up, it just comes out of whatever state, let's say it was powered off and just booting up. We put an artificial delay in place. It can range anywhere from a couple minutes to 15 minutes. So if you're testing this out and wondering, like, come on, this thing isn't fast, you can actually look in the CM notification log, and you can just see that there's an artificial timeout that we do there. And that's, again, just for performance, so you don't have to think about it. But once a client's up and running and it's, you know, after that initial window of time, your actions start to flow quick from then on out. So let me go back to the PowerPoint now. Okay, so for simplifying or the sort of simplification phase here, we did some things, just small, relatively small changes, given all the other work that you've seen previously in this deck or in our end-user experience. Just some friction scenarios. We got feedback that it was a little painful to have to basically serially select one item, and one item, hit install, click another item, hit install. What we did is we added the ability for an end user to basically checkbox a number of different software types, like updates, apps, and be able to hit a button that would, in essence, install them all for the end user. So that's just kind of one of those little friction scenarios that we got out of the product. The only thing you can't do is you can't multi-select OS task sequences, which makes a lot of sense because when you're going to flatten a box, there's no sense selecting a number of other items to install as well. The other thing we did too, maybe more on the administrative side, is we got rid of the ActiveX control. So you don't really have to worry about getting the group policy in place and all the other stuff to make that happen. It's all just Silverlight now. Well, it was Silverlight before, but with Silverlight 5, it eliminated the need for having that separate ActiveX control. PowerShell. So this was just a gigantic amount of work that we put in for PowerShell. If you think about everything that you can do in the administrative console, we basically built a PowerShell commandlet to pretty much do all of that. We really focused on those sort of administrative tasks that you're creating, you're deleting, you're deploying, you know, all those kind of verbs that you might do in the administrative console. We've now built PowerShell commandlets to go do that. And then if you think about all the different objects that we have in our systems, apps, updates, baselines, you name it, that just multiplies out the number of commandlets that were needed there. So we're somewhere in 500, you know, above 500 or so. I forget how that I can't recite right now the actual command that you can run to kind of see all of them. But what we allow you to do is from the administrative console, you click the click where the menu is in the top left, and then you can connect to our PowerShell provider right then and there and start running PowerShell commands. So it's great if you want to do automation. It's, you know, in my opinion, a lot simpler to use than our SDK. And then it also dovetails nicely with a lot of the other System Center Server suite of components that we have out there. For example, you can tie in Orchestrator. You can use that to help automate a lot of your data center deployments as well. And then also your own custom solutions, you can use it to do tasks that you may have had to use the SDK to do in the past. We have a litany of documentation on this as well. Alerts. So alerts were pretty well received. The only thing that we, I guess, didn't get great reception off of is that we made alerts for endpoint protections really nice, but we didn't backport those changes to other features. So what we did in endpoint protection is part of that real-time scenario where you have a malware outbreak and you want to be alerted as quick as possible, the odds of you being at the console were relatively low. Thus, we enabled alerts to send an email for malware outbreak. What we've basically done in SP1 is we enabled email for all alerts. So now for whatever alerts that we have, you can choose whether to subscribe to an email alert or not. That way you don't feel sort of tethered to the console. You can just get the alert and then log in once you receive that. The other thing that we did too is this concept of ignoring alerts. So the best analogy for this is that we have, this may not be super precisely accurate, but it's just a good analogy, is that we had the notion of you could subscribe to, let's say, management point alerts, but we didn't have a way for you to exclude certain, let's call them bad management points. Let's say you have a bad network link or you have something where you just know this one management point is kind of problematic and you don't want that noise in your system. We had no way for you to just ignore that one device except trying to play with RBAC or something, role-based administration, to get that out of your view, and even that was not always possible. So what we did is we just sort of implemented this sort of concept of ignore. It's really a statement that the administrator themselves probably knows what they want to care about a lot, and we shouldn't try to force using the security model, role-based administration, to try to filter out what you can see. So what you as an administrator can do is just elect for this type of object, for this type of server, I want to ignore alerts for those just because I'm not worried about them at all. All right, so this is our kind of summary, obviously the summary slide here. I hope the takeaway is just as simple as tons of changes in SP1. Really focused on how do we empower the end user, how do we provide an experience for those end users to be productive from just a multitude of different devices. And then there's just a set of just changes we've made to help really remove friction just from the product. You can kind of think of them as just, these sort of very isolated fixes that we did to really help, you know, drive certain improvements in certain areas, like we, you know, to help you minimize your needs to set up a distribution point with an Azure distribution point, speed up your ability to run certain admin tasks so you don't have to wait 60 minutes, and just continue to kind of just iterate and provide more value there. The kind of last thing I think I'm supposed to say here, where's my animation? Here it is that if you're interested in trying to win a Windows RT device, please stop by our booth. They have a system set up where you just need to fill out a survey. It's painless. And then you can put your name in the hat to get a device. The only thing the marketing person told me was just make sure you're around for the drawing itself. That's the only real critical thing is you got to fill out the survey and you got to come back for when the drawing actually occurs at 4 p.m. on Wednesday. And, you know, hopefully somebody wins it here. We got a whole bunch of related content, and please fill out your eval form. And if you have questions, you know, please come up, and we'd be glad to help. Thanks for coming.